Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Ben. Good morning, Facebook. Welcome. It's a little cold outside. That's okay. It's warm in here. Yes. So we have some announcements, some things coming up. My name's David. Hello.
Hey.
Oh, hello. Good morning, everyone. I should assume that was bad. So first... first things first, so I don't forget, starting next Sunday after church, the prayer team meet over here. Yes, the team that's praying over here to see Nyla for your schedules. Yes. All right. So, has your life been impacted by ARC? Whether it's from attending the weekly ARC meeting or you a resident in a recovery home, please consider sending us your before and after recovery photos. These will be used in a very tasteful, impactful presentation for the Rise and Shine dinner coming up at the end of April. See Lacey for more details. Okay, so Children's Church every Sunday. Yes, and clap for that too. Breakfast starts at 9:30 a.m. They'll post a menu in the lobby. Susan Lee could use more volunteers to help out with the Children's Church. So if you're interested, you're feeling moved, led by the Lord to do so, please see Susan Lee after church. Some upcoming Wednesday services. March 30th, Desiree McKenzie will be speaking. Then after that, we have Phil Wagner on April 6th. And then Ms. Nyla Barrett on the 13th. Oh, I'm sorry. It'll be Reverend Nyla Barrett on the 6th and Phil Wagner on the 13th.
Okay.
Either way, just come out all the weeks and you won't miss any of them.
Yeah.
So. Oh, yes.
Switch.
We switched it. And so right now we have, we're coming into the softball season coming up. Yes. So, if anyone who's interested in joining the team can attend a team meeting today at Beacon Cafe directly. And then Mr. Mike Lee is going to come up and say his announcements.
Hey, Mike.
You're doing great, Dave.
Bye.
Morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Facebook. Good morning, church. For those of you that do not know me, my name is Michael Lee. I'm very instrumental in this church. I love this church. Been coming here for ages. I have a passion for this church. But the other thing that I have a passion for is sports. Wasn't good enough to become a professional. I threw out my shoulder in college, so probably doesn't want to see me, but God brought me here for a reason. So anyways, with that being said, I am the Akron Area Church League Coordinator, and I'm also the coach for Community of Christ softball team. And all I have to say about this is that I have been a very, very competitive person my whole life. But when I came here, there was a wise man sitting right there who said, Mike, you have to have lower expectations. And I'm like, lower expectations? He's like, you're on this level. They're on that level. Meet them in the middle. And I said, ever since then, I've had so much fun with these people. We take everybody, for an addict, to change our life completely and come here and do this is phenomenal. We've had some very good teams in the past. I know of at least four teams that have won it, and I know of a couple of teams that have won the below 500 things. So we've got the potential there. If you have a passion like I do, I just ask you to come on out. I know it doesn't look like softball weather with the snow. Come on out, have some fun, have some fellowship, get that Christ-likeness in, get that exercise you need, and I'm leaving these final two words, and that's play ball.
Thank you, Mike. So, I'm not much of a softball player, but for those of you, I heard our team's actually pretty good. And so also, we have some special services coming up. Good Friday service, April 15th at 7 p.m. We upstairs here in the sanctuary. Then our Easter Sunday service, the 17th, at 10 a.m. Megan Hello, Megan. Is holding dance rehearsal at 6 p.m. every Wednesday evening leading up to the Easter season. So if you or someone you know likes to dance, come on out. And so I'm going to speak about giving now. Now, I've said it before, and I'll say it again because it's important to me. You know, coming to this place saved my life. It gave me a safe place to stay where I could deal with myself and start establishing a foundation in my own recovery. And I'll say that until the day I die because it's truth. So that's why I give here, because we're still doing the same work that was being done for me when I got here. We're still reaching out to those lost and stuck in darkness, giving them places safe and comfortable home to build a foundation, build a relationship with Jesus. There's many ways to give. I give online. You can text to give. There's the box in the back. You can drop your money back there. You can mail in a check. And also, too, we have the ushers come around if you feel led at that time in the service to give as well. Yes. And also, we are doing a building fund going on now till April 10th. So, again, this is my home church. This has been a home to me and many others for many years. Whatever the God puts on your heart to give is more than welcome. With that, I'd like to start with a little prayer. Father God, thank you for bringing us all here this morning. Thank you for allowing us to be here safely because we're in the place that you need us to be. Open our hearts and our minds to hear your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise.
Holy, holy, yeah. Thank you. Teaching me how to receive. This is my victory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place undefeated with the one who has conquered it.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. my conqueror. You are my victor. What do I have to worry about? It is well with my soul. Whatever's happening right now, it is well. It is well with my soul. You are so good. So good, Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. It is well. It is well. Listen, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. My great-granddaughter was born last Sunday. Hallelujah. She's a chunky little thing, 8 pounds, 10 ounces, almost 9 pounds. Listen, she's been in the hospital this whole time. That's right, she's coming home today. She's coming home today. It is well with my soul. This is how I fought for her all week. This is how I fought for her all week. This is how we fight our battles. I worshiped. I praised. I let others know to pray. I posted on Facebook. Listen, you aren't stopping me. Hallelujah. I have a good, good God. Hey, these are my sisters right here. We was worshiping together today. It was fabulous. It was fabulous. But listen, this is how we fight our battles. We don't fight against flesh and blood. I fight against the spirits of darkness trying to take my grandbaby. Hallelujah. Listen, you're not taking my grandchild. You're not taking her from her mama who lost her dad, who's lost her grandparents. She can't take one more thing. This baby will be well. This baby will be well. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. This is how I fight my battles. Hallelujah. Nice job. Nice job. We'll call the ushers up. Thank you, sir. He's going to help me. Yeah, I think we're going to do this. Thank you. Okay. Oh, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Facebook.
Good morning, Reba.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Reba. I'm the pastor here.
Hi, Reba.
Hello. Good morning. I'm kind of echoey.
Yeah.
Is it me? A little bit. James is working on it. Okay. Listen, enemy has to flee in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So we thank you, Father, that we have the opportunity to be here, to be in this nice, warm place, Father God, that you've provided for us. I know people are out there right now, the homeless, and it's a cold winter's day here in Northeast Ohio. So we thank you, Lord, that I have a warm place, because I've many times not had a warm place. But thank you, God, that I have a warm place. I have a warm place to live. And I have a warm place to come to worship you, Father. So we thank you for that, Lord. We ask that you bless all those who give, bless those that don't have. May you doubly bless those that don't have, Father God. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can pass the baskets. You can turn me down a little bit. Oh, okay. I'm really loud. It's really loud. I mean, I don't mind being loud. hello.
Hello.
Good morning. I'm going to ask a couple, if you want to come up, I'm going to call for some testimonies. So usually we used to run the microphone around, but due to Facebook, it's just challenging that way and safer probably. If you would like to come up and give a testimony, and let me tell you what I'd like to hear. And I feel like God, I was actually going to do it in 2 weeks. In 2 weeks, we're getting ready to ordain Pastor Jim Riffle.
Okay.
Yeah. So you don't want to miss it. And I was going to do testimonies that day, but for some reason, I feel like we're going to do it today. And two things, because you overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
Uh-huh.
And the word of your testimony.
Right.
And last week, we had a wonderful time here. If you weren't here, we had altar time, and it was beautiful. It was so lovely. And we asked people to come up and get the baptism of the Holy Spirit, come up and receive salvation. And a lot of times, people come up, and some people don't. And Pastor Pat used to say, if you wonder what's happening to them when they're up there, go up and ask them. Go up and ask them, what is that experience like? So I thought today I would give you an opportunity. If you had an experience last Sunday and you would like to share about it, I want you to have the opportunity to do that. When I had the baptism of the Holy Spirit, they offered me that opportunity the next Sunday. So, you know, when I, like in my mind, here's what happened when I got the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I felt like, I told you, I had memorized that verse and I kept saying that verse over and over, the Romans 15:13, over and over. And then the next thing I know, I felt like I was swept up into the heavenly realms with God, like I was like Cinderella, and I was like dancing with God, and like I had this language that started coming out that I didn't understand. Listen, it was so crazy. I got, even after and all the way home, I kept having to make myself speak English. Do you mean like I had to consciously think about my words because of what happened to me? So they gave me an opportunity to share that the following Sunday on what happened to me that Sunday. So I want to give you guys an opportunity. If something happened to you or you felt God touch you in some way, I would like you to be able to have an opportunity to come up and talk about that. Because you need to share that. And like I said, you're overcoming by giving the word of your testimony and letting others know kind of what your experience was. So would anyone like to come up and share their experience, if you had an experience last Sunday, to come up? Declan had an experience. Listen, it doesn't have to be, I've had many experiences up here, do you know what I mean? I had an experience, most of the time I have experiences with Jesus and it changes my life. You know, you could just feel warm. I came up one time and just felt like honey got poured all over me.
Amen.
Just honey. Amen. Got poured all over me. You know, just the presence of God. So does anybody? You're gonna make me stand up for myself. No, all did it. Were you here last week? Who was here? Who? Sam, I'm gonna make you raise your hand. I'll come get you. Who came up? Did anybody come up to the altar? You want to come up, Aaron, and share?
Come on, Aaron.
Okay. This is Aaron.
Hi, Aaron.
Hi, how you doing?
This is Aaron. I can't really go on at length about what I felt. I'm 31, and for the majority of that time, I've been an anti-theistic atheist, and I haven't really known or been familiar with what it feels like to feel a higher power, to feel God talking to me or touching me. But I can say what I didn't feel. What I didn't feel is the red-faced, hot sort of shame and embarrassment that I tend to feel whenever I'm up in front of a group of people talking. What I felt was just absolute comfort and peace. And like that was where I was. So, yeah, I don't know. It felt good. And for the first time in a very long time, it felt like I was where I needed to be, like I said.
All right.
All right. Yeah. That's it.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else?
Wow.
Want to come and share? Don't be nervous. Really, I feel like, and if all we had was Aaron's, that was enough. That'll blow you away right there.
Yeah,
when he first started coming here and told me that he used to be atheist, I was like, well, okay, here we go. This is going to be great. Anyone else have an experience you want to share? Where's Trip?
From the 90s?
Pardon me?
You want one from the 1990s?
Sure. Apparently, I'll take whatever I can get right now.
Okay. Hi, my name's Mike.
Hi, Mike.
Way back in the 1990s, this church was well aware of what the revival that was going on in Toronto, Canada. And groups of people were going up to the Toronto Blessing and were bringing the blessing back to this church. And my wife and I, Molly, had planned to go with the group to Toronto. And I wasn't good at managing money back in those days. And I thought I had enough money in the bank to make that trip, but when the time came, the money just wasn't there. And I felt so bad, you know, the group left without us. And that day at church, I was running the overheads. We had an old overhead projector on a stand, and we put the songs up. And the Holy Spirit came on me while I was putting the overheads up, to the point where I couldn't stand. I like backed against the wall, slid down on the floor, and was just enjoying that the Holy Spirit's presence with me.
Amen.
And it was like God just wrapped his arms around me and said, "You don't have to chase me. I can come to you."
And both of those, that's perfect. And that's exactly right. So I just want to say, you know, I hope if you were one of the people up here last week, I'm continuing to pray for you, for that blessing to happen to you. I do know that, like, sometimes with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you kind of have to open your mouth. So you're going to have to sing.
Right.
And you're going to have to declare some scriptures. Do you know what I mean? Like, you kind of gotta open yourself up to it, which is kind of what happened to me, is that I just kept saying that verse over and over again, and then I got my prayer language. And I wanted to, we're going to talk about a couple of things. This is called Suit Up. Suit Up. Suit Up. Yeah. Because this whole past year, and as this church goes forward, I feel like we're going to battle. Okay, we are going to battle. And so in the beginning of the year, we started off with, do you guys remember what we started off the year with? New year, new you. That's right. New year, new you. So we had talked about some basic principles in new year, new you. One of them was to have less stress in our life, to learn to walk in peace. Do you guys remember that? Do you remember the next one?
Be healthy.
Be healthy. We want to be healthy. And the other one? Financial stability. Some people are with me. Okay. So good job. Because, you know, we kind of got to keep our house in order. You have to be ready for battle. Do you know what I mean? And if you're a mess and always trying to put your life back together, it's hard to battle.
Right.
It'd be hard to battle for my grandbaby. Do you know what I mean? If I'm a mess and my house is a mess and everything's a mess. Do you know what I mean? I got all that together now. So now I can go battle for you. Okay, so we started off new year, new you, kind of getting battle ready. You might not have known that's what we were doing, but that's what we were doing. And I'm kind of sticking to it. I'm sticking to my budget. I'm doing some different things with my finances. I have not gone back to eating sugar.
Wow.
I know, right? Thank you. It's God. I was telling Desiree, I used to tell people all the time, I run so I can have cake. Okay, and now I just run, apparently. No more cake. It's fine, I'm fine, it's okay, it's fine, I'm fine. But for some, how, I don't know how, it's God. Do you know what I mean? So if you kind of get in the flow with God, he'll change your whole life. It's not even been that hard. In fact, last week I went to Sugar Creek, Amish country. Never been down there. Do you know they have a thing called donut cake? Homemade ice cream? Like, why am I here?
Yeah.
I'm here. That's the wrong place for me to be. Listen, here's how I feel. That's the enemy. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke you. Get away from me. Like, I don't even want it. It's just the craziest thing. But God's getting me battle ready. Do you know what I mean? Because I need to be fit and strong for where we're going. We were in prayer the other day, and I was saying, David Hinkle was with us. He joined us. We do a Friday prayer at 11:30. I love where I work. We just had prayer time at my job. I said, I feel like when we first started this, when we were making the transition from Pat stepping away and me stepping forward, I felt like I was on one of those big sailboats, you know, like on Pirates of the Caribbean. It was one of those big boats, and it was like leaving the dock, so it was creaky, and we were all excited because we're getting ready to take sail, and we're getting ready to go, and during this transition, I feel like we had a shipwreck, I don't. We just had a bunch of stuff that's happened. We had squirrels. I mean, it's just been floods. It's but the other day when we were praying, I said I can feel like the ship is sailing. Like we're going fast now. Like we're moving. Do you mean I could feel the water under the boat? All and right. Like everyone is ready, and we kind of already know what to expect. And now we're just sailing. We're just kind of out here moving. So that's what I feel like. Like, that's what we need to be ready for, because we're all going to move forward, because we want to go out there and change our city. Amen. And I believe that's kind of been the vision all along. You guys used to do a walk or a march for Jesus across the city. Yep. So this church has always been about the city and helping the city. So we're getting battle ready, and we need to suit up. So I'm going to the verse in Ephesians. Battle ready. So we're getting battle ready. I feel like we also talked about take off the grave clothes. You got to let some things go. Yep. You know what I mean? You got to step out. You're going to be uncomfortable. You got to take off those old smelly grave clothes. You know, whatever that means for you. Apparently it was sugar for me. I don't know. But whatever that means for you, could be toxic situations, toxic environments, toxic people. Whatever that means for you, step out. Take off those grave clothes. Step into the new. And then we talked about the Holy Spirit, okay? Being bold and having the Holy Spirit, because these are the things that you need, I feel like, to be battle ready. You're going to need the power of the Holy Ghost to help you move forward.
Amen.
So this is where we are. So Ephesians 6:10. So I feel like we're all getting ready, and now we're going to put on the armor. Ephesians 6:10. This is an amazing... one of my favorite books in the New Testament is Ephesians, and this is the end of it, and we're going to start in 10, and it says, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Actually, another version of this says, be strong in the Lord and let him empower you.
Yes.
Let him empower you, because that's what the Holy Spirit's kind of doing. It's now empowering you. So be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. You guys, you'll remember this from Angel. Verse 11, put on the full armor of God so that you can take the stand against the devil's
schemes.
And she's not here to experience that with us. I said, I'm using your schemes. The devil's schemes. So everyone was paying attention. She did This Means War. You guys remember that? That's yes. The series that she was doing, This Means War. So we're kind of still on the same path. This Means War. So we're looking out, we're taking a stand against the devil's schemes, against the devil's plots, against the devil's plans, against the devil's methods. So we're coming against the devil's schemes. I even looked up devil. In the Greek, it's diabolos. Diabolos? Like where the word diabolical comes from. So he has all kinds of schemes. We already all know that. If you live on this planet any amount of time, you know the enemy's out. And you've actually probably been battling this whole time, and you might not even know that's what you've been doing, trying to get through. So, 12. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So the first thing I want to point out is that our battle is not against... flesh and blood. Flesh and blood. The battle is not against flesh and blood. Okay? We're not fighting each other. We shouldn't be fighting each other. Our battle isn't against human beings. Okay? The enemy will use spirits that kind of can, and he can utilize humans, do you know what I mean, for his schemes, his plots, his methods, but that is not who our battle is against. Okay? The battle is never against your boss. The battle is never against Putin. Right? That's not who our battle is against. They'll just be somebody else. Do you know what I mean? Our battle is against the spiritual forces that are trying to take over this world and do bad things to people. Okay, that's what we're going to fight against. And this is why our battle looks different than it would on a normal physical battlefield. Listen, when we did, I texted Desiree this morning and said, can we please do it as well with my soul? Right? That was a God thing. Can we please do it as well with my soul? Listen, I saw myself like on a cliff in Ireland. I mean, I could actually feel it. I felt like I was right there, just me and God. Probably because it looks like Ireland right now, too. It's gray and cold. That's what Ireland looks like. And I felt like it was me and God, and the wind is blowing, and we're battling. Do you know what I mean? I'm battling in my spirit. I'm battling in my spirit. I'm battling for my son right now. You know what I mean? I'm battling for my granddaughter right now. That's what I'm doing in worship. So, you know, and however it works for you, some people sit, some people stand. I'll kneel sometimes. I've heard Pastor Pat got on his head before, stood upside down. It's like, yeah. That's a true story. Do you know what I mean? I've seen Michelle walk around this whole room. Do you know what I mean? Wherever the Spirit leads her, you know? We're battling. That's what we're doing. If you don't know what we're doing, that's probably what we're doing, is we're battling right then. And where we're placed, there's always a battle here.
Yes.
Listen, we got the community-based correctional facility right there. You think there aren't evil forces over there trying to take those men's lives?
That's right.
We're battling, okay? We got Summit County Jail right here. You think there aren't evil forces trying to destroy their lives? Listen, and to me, they're in a place of redemption. Do you know what I mean? If we can get through, break through those forces, when I open up my mouth, miracles come pouring out.
Amen.
You got to open up your mouth.
Yes.
Okay, you're going to have to say it. You're going to have to sing it.
Right.
You got to open up your mouth. The enemy doesn't want you to. Just sit there. You can just enjoy the service.
Uh-huh.
Listen, we don't have spectators here. Don't be a spectator here. We're battling. Okay, we're battling for people's lives, for people's souls,
Amen.
For people's children.
Yeah.
Do you know how many people we had at youth group last week? Where's RJ? 14. 14. We're battling. I'm battling to change the world with our young people. We're battling. Absolutely. You should see, we're going to post some of their videos. They were playing some kind of crazy game. It's hilarious to watch them down there. But we're battling. So my battle is not against the guy in Summit County Jail. My battle is against the spirit that's driving him, or the ancient curse on his life. I'm trying to break those things down. Okay, that's what we're battling against, not against people. I used to think it was my boss, but it's not my boss. She was actually a tool for God. I thought it was the enemy. So be careful. So you know what I mean? So we're not battling against flesh and blood. We're really battling against spiritual forces, darkness. It says he's the prince of the air, the enemy, the devil, diabolos. He's the prince of the air. So that's what we're battling against. So it's not going to look like, you know, a military battle, although it is, because it's very strategic and it's very powerful. Anyway, let me move along. Okay. So, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. You know, discrimination is a spiritual dark force.
Come on.
That's a dark force. It's been operating in America for a long time. It needs to stop.
All
How
right.
do we stop it? With love.
All right.
We're going to stop it with love.
Amen.
Okay? I'm not going to fight against an individual person. Do you mean I'm going to fight with love? Everyone is the same. Galatians tells us everyone is the same. Men, women, slave, free, black, white, Jew, Greek, Hebrew, male, female, we're all the same.
Amen.
Everyone deserves the same.
Amen.
Okay, 13, therefore put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, and it'll come, it always comes.
Yeah.
I used to say when I was using, tomorrow always comes, because you know I put stuff off till tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll deal with it tomorrow. I'll pay the rent tomorrow. I'll get the money tomorrow. Tomorrow comes. It always comes. The day of evil always comes. We live in a dying place. The day of evil comes, verse 13, so that you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, you stand. That's one of my most favorite verses. After you've done everything, you keep standing.
Yep.
When I lost my son, I'm going to keep on standing.
That's right.
I've done everything I can do, but I'm going to keep standing.
Yep.
You know, I feel like when you're in a battlefield and they put you in position and they're like, hold your ground, hold your ground, hold your ground, hold your ground. You hold your ground. Hold your ground. Don't let the enemy through. Hold your ground. If you've done everything else, you just keep standing there. You just keep standing.
Amen.
Don't let the enemy knock you down. If he does, I'm getting back up. I'm getting right back up. I'm getting right back up. Not like I don't go through stuff. I'm human. I go through stuff. We all go through stuff. Do you know what I mean? But I'm gonna rally. I'm gonna come back. I have the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the only way I could do this. Listen, I couldn't get out of a basement on my own.
Come on.
I was telling Angel earlier, I'm not confused about who I am. Well, we were saying about, don't put all your hope in me. You know what I mean? I know what I'm capable of. You put your hope in God. You put your hope in God. Because listen, I can mess this whole thing up in about 3 days. About 3 days. I can mess this whole thing up. Okay, it's God. It's all God. It's always God. It's going to be God. But I do what I need to do today so that I'm here tomorrow. I do what I need to do today so that I'm here tomorrow.
All right.
That's all I got. So you keep standing. Put on the full armor so that you're ready. The day will come. When I got ready to move into the recovery house, the day before, my husband said, you don't need to go to the recovery house. And I said, what? I said, no, I'm going. He's like, well, I'm moving out. You can just have this house. Listen, I had 27 days clean. You are not knocking me over.
Come on.
I've been through some stuff. Okay? So if you think that the world is supposed to be all happy now, that you're on the right path, doing the right thing, listen, the enemy's going to come hard, and that's why I'm giving you this message. Because I feel like we're tough people. This is a tough church. We've been through some stuff. And I feel like you're okay about going through some stuff if you know that you're going to go through some stuff. You know what I mean? I'm telling you, wrap your head around it because you're going to go through some stuff. And once you know that, you'll be like, okay, I can get ready for that. It's like if the devil deceives you and think, oh, life should be lovely now, and you're going to live on a pink cloud. It's still the same world. It's still the same place. Okay? So get ready. I'm getting you ready. We're gonna battle because this is the dying place. This is the evil place. But we're here. So we bring the goodness and the light and the brightness and the love. Okay? But you're going to go through some stuff. I've been through some stuff. But listen, it only made me stronger. You can go one of two ways. You can fall down or you can stand.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to stand. I fell down my whole life. Followed, chased that little lying devil all around. Woe was me, my childhood, blah, blah, blah. Until when I moved into the recovery house and I heard him again, I said, not today. I'm tired of listening to you. I'm tired of listening to you. It's gotten me nowhere. 46 years old in a recovery house. That's where it got me. So we're going to listen to God. We're going to suit up. We're going to get ready for battle.
Amen.
Okay. So verse 14. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. 16. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith, which can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions, yes, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me. Listen, this is Paul. Pray also for me that whenever I speak words, the words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Okay, this is Paul in prison writing this to us. This is a guy in jail trying to give us a hope shot. That's amazing to me.
Yeah.
And let me tell you why it's amazing to me. Because it's not like jail in America, where you still have rights, and they're still going to treat you well. And you might not think that they do. Go to a jail in another country. They don't care about your rights over there. They don't care if you're hungry. They don't care if you're sick. It's a whole different kind of jail.
Amen.
Paul is writing from a jail. From what I've studied, their jails were usually outside of the city, and where they put the trash, where the waste goes, like where the sewage goes, that's where the jail is. And some of these chapters, he's singing in jail, like probably his feet in crap, and he's singing in jail. So listen, so I take hope in that, because that is not my plight. Do you know what I mean? Nothing I go through is that desperate or despairing, you know? So this is coming from a man who's in jail, in chains, and he's in chains because of his proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. Yeah. They're trying to stop him from telling people about Jesus. He tells everybody he can tell. He writes to everyone he can write to. He tells the jailers. He tells his cellmate. He tells everybody about Jesus. And that's why he's in chains. So that's our hope shot. I'm not in jail. Do you mean so I can take comfort in knowing that if he can get through that, I can get through almost anything here on this earth. Do you mean it's not going to be that challenging for me? So the armor is for our protection. So he actually did name armor and named weapons. And I kind of want to talk about those. And I'm going to do it kind of quickly. So suit up. Ready? Suit up. Got me, Miss Rachel? Got me. Suit up. First one is the belt of truth. The belt of truth. And so I think about this. I kind of looked it up. It says it holds the tunic in place. It secures the breastplate that we're going to talk about. But it also holds your weapons. It holds your weapons. Okay, so this is an important piece of armor. Or if you think of it like a carpenter and his tool belt, that's what you have here. It's hard to work and hard to fight if you don't have them right there with you and available to you and easily to get to. So it's the belt of truth. I say it's the truth of God. Because the enemy's going to try to take away who God is. There's not really a God. Really? All this craziness? You think some big being did this? Do you know? Yes, there's a God. If you don't believe me, go back and find John Hovind's message on the beginning of time and creation. It was excellent in how it came into being with the great creator, God. You can't do all that God says you can do. Listen, right. You can.
Yes.
The truth is, you can. Listen, I am clean and sober today. That's a truth. Yeah. I got that way because God.
Yeah.
I've been to treatment. I did meetings. The thing that's different is I added God to the equation and it all changed.
Yes.
It all changed.
Yeah.
That's the truth. Yeah. The devil doesn't want you to know who God is and who you are in God. That there is one God, the only God, and that he came and died for you. Okay, that's the truth. So you want to hold on to that because you're going to need it throughout your life. Because the enemy's going to try to come and deceive you and be like, that ain't true. That ain't true. Well, look, he took your grandma. God didn't take your grandma. Do you think your grandma was going to get out of here and not die? Like, we're all going to, if you don't know this, newsflash, we're all going to die. It's the dying place. And God didn't do it. Sin did it. Do you know what I mean? Just go back and study for yourself. Stick with the truth. Stick with the truth.
Come on.
Okay. Breastplate of righteousness. I'm going to get through these. Breastplate of righteousness. Listen, righteousness, justice, fairness, equality. These are the things that you need to have in your heart. That's why you want the righteous breastplate right up here to protect your heart. Because when you're unfair, unkind, unjust, it does something to your heart. Okay? You need to protect that now because that's where God is. That's love. He's going to help you be fair, be kind, be just. So breastplate of righteousness. Do the right thing. You know what the right thing is. If you have God, he will tell you. If you can't hear him, be quiet for a minute. He will tell you.
Amen.
Don't go that way.
Amen.
He would tell me all the time when I was getting high, don't do it.
Yep.
I don't hear that.
Yep.
I would override it. Do you know what I mean? And you can override it till it's really, really quiet. You can't hardly hear it anymore. But it's still there. He will talk to you. He will tell you what's right for you.
Yes.
Okay, so follow that. Okay. All right. The shoes of the gospel of peace. The good news of Jesus brings you peace. He has you. So the gospel is the good news that brings you peace, and it makes you ready to go out and share with others. Do you know what I mean? Like, I have good news now. The world's not all dark. There's not we're not all evil. We're not all going to hell in a handbasket. Do you know what I mean? There's goodness and love. Good news. Jesus came to save. That's the good news. Everyone came to save everyone. It's the good news. And listen, once you know what the good news is, it helps guide your steps.
Yep.
The shoes of peace.
Yep. Come on.
Oh, that didn't feel too good. I'm going to go back over this way.
Yes.
The gospel of peace. It's the good news. It's the good news.
Yeah.
So stick with the good news. Shield of faith. Listen, this thing amazes me, this shield of faith. They say the shields that, so they took a lot of this from the Roman guards, okay, because that's who was running the world at this time. So the shields that the Roman guards have, and you've probably seen them in some of the movies, they're tall. They're like really tall, almost like a door, almost the size of a door. And then they took hide and covered the steel or the wood with the hide. They secured it with iron on the top and the bottom. And then if they could, they'd get it wet because the enemy would come with arrows, darts of arrows that were on fire. They would call what's called pitch, put it on the end of the arrow, light it, shoot it. Well, this shield would distinguish the fiery darts.
Amen.
The shield would distinguish the fiery darts. So spiritually for us, the fiery darts are, you can't do that. You'll never be able to do that.
Come on,
it's
yeah.
always been this
That's
way.
Right.
You've always been a drug addict. You're always going to have depression. Nothing's ever going to be better. That's the fiery darts.
Yeah.
The shield of faith is, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am more than a conqueror through Christ.
Amen.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue that comes against me shall be found to be in the wrong. That's my shield of faith. That's my shield of faith. That's why I can stand up here and say, my granddaughter needs to come home. I'm blessed according to the word of God. My children are blessed according to the word of God. Their children are blessed according to the word of God. I'm standing on the word of God. That's my shield of faith. I'm going to whip out my faith and say, not today. Not today, devil. And I got me some scriptures to back myself up for whatever I need. For healing, if you're sick, get you some scriptures. Start saying them. I heard Joel Osteen's mom had like fourth stage cancer. She walked around her driveway quoting scripture, found all the healing scripture she could get. This was like 12 years ago. She's still alive today.
Amen.
She got her some faith, got her some scriptures that knocked down all those fiery darts of that enemy trying to come and make her sick and not well, trying to attack your finances. Whatever the enemy's trying to do, you get you some scriptures with the shield of faith. Distinguish all those fiery darts.
Yes.
Listen, he don't have no new strategies, no new ideas. Pastor Pat says the enemy has like 11 lies. That's all he's got. You know, once you figure out the first one's the lie, you can go, well, that one's a lie. Well, then that must be a lie. And then they're all lies. Like when he did it to me in the house and he said, listen, no one will know. I was like, oh, that's a lie. Because if I do this, I will wake up in the morning and look in the mirror, and I'm going to feel like crap. I'll know.
Yes,
right. Listen, I bought that thing for years. Well, no one will know. No one cares. You're not hurting anyone. Lies. All lies.
Yeah.
All lies.
Yeah.
They're just lies. Listen, I matter.
That's
right. I'm important.
Amen.
I know.
Yep.
Okay? Shield of faith. Helmet of salvation. I'm going to call the worship team up, too. I'm going to get through these last couple ones. So, helmet of salvation. Listen, if you accepted Jesus, you're saved. If you accepted Jesus, you're saved. I have a friend who she thinks every time she sins again, she has to rededicate her life. I'm like, that's exhausting. I'm like, I'm going to have to be doing that all day long. You know what I mean? Like, as soon as I leave here, I probably had a bad thought. I'm going to have to repent and turn it back around. Listen, once you're saved according to the word of God. He came and died for you. It's not about you.
All right.
It's not how good you are, how bad you are. It's a gift that he just gives to you. And I don't care what your past is. I don't care what your future is. Once you accept God, he's yours. You're his. That's it. It's the helmet of salvation. You know, treasure that knowledge. Keep that knowledge. Hold on to that knowledge. Don't let anyone take that knowledge. Don't let the enemy make you feel bad about yourself anymore. Listen, I was just telling Sam. Where's Sam? Did he leave? There's Sam. I said, Sam, you know, we're just having a human experience here. So we're going to be afraid sometimes. You know what I mean? I'm going to mess up. I'm going to cuss somebody out. I'm going to get irritated. I'm going to get frustrated. I'm going to say that I'm having a human experience here and it's okay. God already knew that. He already knows your tomorrow. He already knows you're going to blow it. It's okay. Listen, that's why we have grace and mercy. I mean, Deborah was here a couple of Wednesdays ago, and she talked about the mercy of God in her life. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jesus, for mercy. Right. Sword of the Spirit. Sword of the Spirit. Listen, this is one of the only weapons that's actually offensive. You're going to use it. Okay, and that's what I said even about, like, knowing your scriptures. You're going to go on the attack with the sword of the Spirit. It's not something that's blocking something. You're actually going out and fighting now. Your sword of the Spirit, there you go. He's holding it up. It's the word of God. You hold up the word of God. Hold on to the word of God. Whatever the word of God says. Yes. Yeah, that's your sword. That's your sword. That's what's going to make a difference. That's why I say I stand up here and declare freedom for the people in Summit County Jail according to the word of God. He came and died, shed his blood so that we could be free. That's the word of God. That's my sword. Okay? So, let's stand. I'm going to read these, go over this last one with you. Finish reading it because it also says pray in the Spirit. And that's one of the things that I think we got last week is if you got a language with God, your prayer language, I have a prayer language. I pray in the Spirit all the time, all the time. But it also says pray for each other. So we're all in the battle together. Do you know what I mean? So you ever seen like in a battlefield and they all hold up their shields? You know, like if they have those doors like I was talking about, they can make a whole fort around each other with those shields. Do you know what I mean? They can hold them. Each one holds the shield up over their head. They're protected. They go like this. They can move mountains with those shields. So we're in this together. You're not alone. But let me read this Psalms to you. Psalms 27. This is how I fight my battles. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advances against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me, and his sacred tent I will sacrifice with shouts of joy, and I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word, Lord. We thank you that you've given us all that we need to go out and fight our battles, Lord, to declare goodness and victory and love for Jesus. Through these doors, we go out into the city, and we proclaim goodness and love and mercy and grace, Father. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I lift my voice and shout. Every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles call start breaking out. I have the authority. Voice and shout, every voice.
Downstairs. Just come to the meeting, even if you don't know how to play. It's fun. See you down there. Goodbye.